Welcome, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Glad you're here, sir. I'll be, it's recording, so we'll be talking a little bit about some photo stuff today that I think is important. And hopefully we'll bring
Hi, Don.
Value. Hi, Lee. How are you?
Pretty good.
All right. So Sid will not be joining us today. He is on his shoot, his big portrait shoot. So we will have to mutter along without him, without our fearless leader. Okay, before I start out, it's Photo Talk Friday. So do you guys have anything you would like to bring up? Because this is all about you guys. Anything? All right. Well, we'll just get into it then. Well, one of the things that I was doing this past week is organizing my cameras and my gear, and it over the past, I guess, 4 years, I've probably accumulated far more cameras and gear and stuff than I ever should have, and so it's been quite a job. Still not finished with it, but in the end I think I'll be getting rid of some gear. Part of me is actually thinking of getting rid of all the Canon gear that I have and all the Nikon gear except for one lens and one camera, and going with something smaller like Fuji, but I don't know yet. We'll see. Those big cameras have a different ergonomics, and I really do like the smaller cameras for a lot of reasons. Anyway, so those things have been on my mind. Also on my mind is what's happening to some of my photographer friends overseas are just being decimated by stupid governments and lockdowns that obviously don't work and all kinds of crap. And I don't know if we're going to get to a point where some of these guys in France and Spain and Italy, Portugal, I don't know if we're going to get to a point where they just simply can't recover. And that will put out of business all the middle to lower tier photographers and leave just the already giant photographers at the top with literally no way to get up there. So that's been weighing on me. I don't know what I can do about that, but I wish I could send them all a passport. Anyway, other things that are in the news. We talked a little bit last week about the DxO software. I wanted to reiterate that I've been using it all week on some older files. Wow, does it really, really work? Really does the job. Better actually than I think it even purports to. So it's been pretty cool. One other thing before we get started on my topic, I have decided to take a social media break on the weekends. I will no longer be on social media on the weekends. I'm going to try it out, see what happens. I find myself spending too much time on that stuff on the weekends and not enough time doing some of the other things that I enjoy doing. So other than checking email and writing my blog posts, I'll be staying off most social media for the foreseeable weekend futures anyway. Listening to James Altucher earlier this week, and something he said really crunched a nerve with me. And he said, is it better to be better? Or is it better to be the only? And actually, I think it's better to be the only. Now, we humans take that to mean like, oh, no, we're the only ever. Well, there's, on a planet with, 10 billion people on it, that's probably pretty hard to be the only anything. But let's take it back down to photography. Let's just take it right into where our world is. This is where personal projects become one of the biggest I guess, producers of the only that we can possibly get. Because you can be a great photographer and you can be better than other photographers. But if you're the only photographer that does fill in the blank, then you're the only, and that really makes a difference. Way back when, back in the early, maybe early mid 2000s, I was doing blurb books. I was doing my first books in blurb, and on my coffee table in the studio, my coffee table, I had a book on portraiture. I had a book on shooting men, a book on shooting women, and a couple of other little books. Now, these were not like Amphoto how to do it books. They were very simple books, but it was interesting to see how clients would react to that. Because I could basically say, well, you could hire somebody else to do, you know, your social media portrait or your business portrait, or you could hire me. I'm the guy who wrote the book on it. So instantly, I'm an only. Not that I'm the only photographer that's ever written a book, but all the other photographers that I knew in Phoenix, I was the only one who had done the book. When I published the books with Amherst, I'm the only photographer in Phoenix, well, in Arizona anyway, who's ever published a book through a major publisher that's on Amazon. I'm the only one. That carries weight. I've got to learn how to throw that weight around because I don't do it very much, but that does carry weight. Personal projects can give you the impetus to step in to be the only. Maybe you're the only one that's photographed 50 chefs in your town, or you're the only one that's photographed 25 power plants all over your region. You set yourself apart. You set yourself way apart. One of the reasons I like doing books and recommend to all of you guys to do books is it sets you apart. We all know some really great photographers out there, and we also know some great photographers who've never made a book. Not a portfolio, but a book, which really could be like writing 10 paragraphs and throwing 25 pictures into a blurb template to make a book, but they don't do it. When you do something that no one else does, when you do something that few other people do, you become an only. And it can be a gigantic boost to what you do. You've got to market it. You've got to talk it up. You've got to, you know, be the person who blows your own horn. But if you've got something to blow that horn about, it's really, really a powerful thing to do. Now, we got Kevin Carson on here. Kevin won a pretty prestigious award in LA, right, Kevin?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
Damn prestigious award.
So,
you have ball caps and t-shirts made up with that? That award?
No.
Yeah, well, you should.
It's just hanging on the wall. But, you know, it was,
what's the name of the award?
Well, I got the Photojournalism Photographer of the Year, from the California, Professional Photographers of California. And I was at an air show and I shot the Thunderbirds handheld with my 400 millimeter 2.8 lens. And the photograph is so sharp that you can see all four pilots and all four of the aircraft. So
I think you ought to have that made into a little logo, those four aircraft. Have a t-shirt that says, "Hi, I'm Kevin Carson. I won the Photojournalist of the Year, and you didn't."
Yeah.
That's it. That's all it needs to say on there.
Yeah.
But seriously, I hope that you're letting people know. I think it's something that it should be on your letterhead.
Oh, yeah. It's on all my email
card and
stuff. Right. Yeah. So. A
great way to be the only.
It's quite an honor. So. And then it got that same photograph ended up in the Professional Photographers of America's International Photographic Competition. It ended up in the loan book, so I was pretty proud about that as well.
Absolutely. So
that's a pretty prestigious award there.
Yeah, when you use competitions, when you enter competitions, that's another way to be the only. If you win, you're the only one that won. When you are chosen as a runner-up or anything like that, you're the only one usually in your area. Sophie's in Antibes, France. I can't imagine there would be that many other photographers entering that thing. Her only competition is her good friend. So, you know, it's either going to be Sophie or, it's not that many people. Not that many people vying for it. It's Carmen or Sophie, and that's it. And
there's a few other photographers in town.
No, they suck.
But we're the coolest ones.
You're the coolest ones. All right, we'll go with that. We'll go with that. Yeah, I don't want to be rude to people I don't know. At least I want to say publicly I don't want to be rude to people I don't know, but privately, all bets are off. the ways to be the only are so myriad, and I think the best way is personal projects. I think when you look at someone's portfolio, that's going to be a kind of a standard portfolio approach, a lot of pictures. So when you get to those personal projects, you may be the only photographer that's photographed ranch hands on a ranch up in Montana, for instance. Those are all really powerful things. People want to work with people that inspire them. And I think too many photographers want to go down the road of making sure they touch all of the little checkbox of what everybody else has done. And I think, well, some of that is valid. Some of it might be too much. We're afraid to step out. You know, step out and be noticed. What do you think about that, folks?
Hey, Don, can I say something?
Yeah.
And please. I think I echo exactly what you say, because I think for us photographers who would like to do more and to express your voice, sometimes it's kind of scary to say something. With photography, you need to have the desire to say it and execute it to the point that says, okay, this is what I want to say. This is the one I want to convey it. And this is the way I want people to react to my images. And you hope that the message goes through to what you want it to say. And when that happens, it's so absurd. But I think also, If you do a project, it has to be extremely honest, because it passes through.
Oh,
you
can
see honesty in your photographs. And if they might not be the greatest ones of all, but if they are honest, I think they really reach people. Or you really capture the people.
You bring up a great point. In a quest to be the only, or to do something that you could be known for, the only in some sort of way, in the quest for that, if you're just looking around for something that no one else has done that you can do, that's not the same. It's got to be authentic. It's got to be real. It's got to be something that you're really interested in, because if you try to fake it, I don't think it ever works.
No.
I've tried to fake it. I'll admit that. I've tried to fake it. That never works.
No.
I've tried to say, oh, well, everybody's doing this, I'll jump in and do that, even though I really didn't like it. For a number of years there was this website called The Strobist. And everybody was taking their strobes outside and using their strobes outside. And it was like a fad. It was like everybody was doing it. And I'm like, okay, well, I'll do it too. It's not my kind of photography. I did not end up with, after like 3 or 4 years of doing that a lot, I ended up with a lot of likes and a big Flickr page of a lot of people going, oh, this is really cool. And I think, but it was not my, those pictures, and I don't show those pictures anymore. They're not interesting to me. I tried to do somebody else's gig instead of my gig. And since I'm old enough to be the first original photographer ever, I think everybody who's making photographs is pretty much copying me. I'm just saying. I'm at least as old as the eye level viewfinder. Okay, can we go with that? That one, I think so. I don't remember too many other eye level. The SLR, how's that? The ways that you promote that you know, so many different ways, but I love books. And I've said this to the Project 52 folks. I want you to make a book. I don't care if it doesn't sell. I don't care if you only make one copy and stick it on your website and put a price point of $125 for it. If someone buys it, awesome. You're going to make $50 and send them a cool book through Blurb, because you're just going to call, you're just going to notify Blurb and they'll make another book for you, right? But even if you don't sell it, do you see how it singles you out? Because I can click over here to a whole, we can go through the next hour of great photographers who have no book for sale. They've never taken the time, the effort, the energy, or whatever to create a book. When you do that and you have the book, it does give you a certain level of credibility, of the fact that you spent the time, the energy to create it, and it does set you apart. Does it have to be great? I don't know. I've got a couple of books around here that aren't all that great and were really famous. But then great is in the eye of the beholder, right? I can't do great. I can't make my work great. I can only make it mine. That's it. I can't make it great. That's for someone like you to decide. It's always been my pet peeve. And then I realized I got about 36 pet peeves. So it's one of my pet peeves when photographers go, Don Giannetti creative photography. I'm going to go like, well, okay, it's Don Giannetti photography. Whether it's creative or not is not your call. That's what your viewers will decide if it's creative. Other people decide that. You just make the work. That's why I say embrace the work. You cannot control the outcome. You can make all the right moves. We talk about portfolios all the time in Project 52. You make all the right moves. You put this picture in. You agonize over the flow of your book. In some cases, like Judy's portfolio is $1,600 book. 40-page book, $1,600. It's an astounding piece of art, right? You can do that. But once it sits down in the art director's desk, they're the one that makes the decision to hire you. And you have absolutely no control over that. None whatsoever. You can do everything you can. You can be courteous. You can be friendly. You can engage them in conversation, but you can't make them buy. I can't make you buy my book at Barnes & Noble or wherever books are sold. I love that statement. I can't make you buy my book at the bookstore. I can get the best cover. I can put the best typography. I can do everything I can do, but I can't make the person pick the book up. At that point, it's out of my hands. And so I find that people spend more time worrying about the outcome. Photographers who have never made a book before will say, yeah, but you know, it's going to cost me $25 to print it. And you know, if I probably can't sell it for more than $35. So I'm only going to make $9. I want to go, hey, time out. Why in the hell do you think you're going to sell one of them? How do you have some kind of crystal ball? You're going to sell a book? You're not going to sell. You don't have no control over how many people buy your book. Just make the book. Get that done. We'll worry about the next part later down the road.
And making $10 a book, by the way, is far more than you make if you publish it traditionally. My books for Amherst sold for, well, their list price was, I want to say $27.95, $26.95, somewhere over $25 was the list price. Generally found them everywhere for $19. I got $1.41 for every book that sold. So if I sell a book and get $10, I'm ahead per unit. Not volume, of course. I just got my quarterly income. I just got my check, my quarterly royalty. I can't remember the name of it because there's so little of it. But I got my quarter royalty check. 3 books in print. I just got a whopping $8.42. That goes right into my savings account, which is climbing close to 100 now. I also got my quarterly royalty from Creative Live substantially higher, which I'm eternally grateful for having the opportunity to do that at Creative Live, because it does I do get a pretty hefty check 4 times a year. And that makes me an only, by the way, right? I'm the only photographer in Phoenix who's ever done a crit. No, I'm not. No, I'm one of only 2. Mark, whatever that idiot Mark guy that used to do a lot of videos, that moron, he did Creative Live. So I'm one of only two Phoenix morons to ever do a Creative Live. And I did 2 of them, by George. I wish I'd done a third. Anything you can do to become the only, other than serial killing? Let's wipe that off right now. You don't want to be the only serial killer photographer. It will not help you. I can see Sophie right now going, oh, that's disappointing.
I got the t-shirt with the camera that says I shoot people for a living though.
Yeah. There you go. Well, I did a whole promo back in, I want to say 80 81. I did a promo and we sent it out, and it had a picture of a person on in the back, and you could right over the camera, and there was an umbrella, you know, lighting umbrella. It was a brick wall behind my studio. And the headline said, sometimes we just take them out back and shoot them. I got 2 jobs from that promo. One of them was a copywriting job, which I was happy to do. But you know, you try everything you can to be unique. We try everything we can to be better. But do you see how better is an impossible? See how better is an impossible measurement? What is better? Who is better? What can we do to make a better photograph? I always go back to the truth. Richard Avedon, one of the greatest photographers of the 20th century, Richard Avedon did not get every job he sent his book out for. So when you think, wait a minute, you mean somebody picked up Richard Avedon's book and said, yeah, I don't know about Dick. No, we're going to go with Harry. It's true. He didn't get every job he submitted his book for. We can't please everybody because we don't know what it is that pleases them. Everybody has a different way of saying what is good. Comparing the work of Tim Tatter to the work of Sam Elkins would be a waste of time. Tim Tatter is a assembly photographer. He'll shoot 15 images and assemble them in Photoshop to create otherworldly things. Sam Elkins shoots on film and does nothing but, you know, hits it with a contrast tweak. What's better? I don't know. I don't know what's better as a photograph. I don't know what's better for a client. Well, as a designer, as a
Art is art director in the agency days, we have clients come in and say, Don, would it be better if that were blue? And I'd say, no, it would be blue. Better, we don't know. There's certain little things. If you want, like it's always been known that if you want to do trust, if you want to build trust, you go with greens and blues. If you want to be forward thinking, you kind of go with oranges and yellows, you know, those kinds of things. But those are not carved in stone. They're not carved in stone. They're just sort of, you know, if 1,000 people, maybe, you know, X amount would move that way. Maybe. So better? Mm-mm. By the way, I think I figured out why I'm coughing a lot. They changed my medication on me. And I looked up the side effects of this new medication that they're giving me. And it says a post-nasal drip and cough. So me and the doc are going to have a chat, like, because this is not working, dude. It's like putting me back on the other stuff.
Is it lisinopril?
No, I was on lisinopril, and lisinopril never made me cough. Then then they moved me to another one, and I don't remember it. Then this month they moved me to a different one, but it's making me cough, just like this lisinopril coughing thing. And that's your pharmacy education for Friday. So take that to the bank, folks. We just discussed heart medicine on Photo Talk Friday.
Now you're the only photographer that can write him a prescription.
I'm probably the only photographer that takes the weird cocktail that I take. But on May 17th, they may take me off most of it because I've lost my weight. My blood pressure is really good. I got no sugar in my body. I'm walking 3 miles a day. I'm feeling really good. Let's see, maybe it's time to get off some of this stuff. I hope. I'd rather they put me on something like, you know, a daily donut. I can hope for that. I don't think that's going to happen, but it is in, you know, it's in my wishes.
Daily tacos, Don, daily tacos. Well,
that's already been done, buddy. I'm already doing daily tacos. That's Lauren, were you around when I did my motorcycle trip last year? No, you weren't. Yeah, you were.
Yeah, we're.
I ate tacos every day, except the one day I had pizza because the taco shop wasn't open.
I know we helped you fund that.
Yes. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. I had some Virginia. I had some amazing tacos and I had some really bad tacos. And you think, how can somebody screw up a taco? Trust me, the folks in Montrose, Colorado worked their ass off. Could be the worst taco on the planet. They do that
in Hawaii too. Like, there's the only good taco place just closed. Well, they retired, but
see,
it's homemade tacos from now on.
See, that would be reason for me to move right there. It's like, yeah. So, and why are you selling the house, Mr. Giannetti? There's no tacos, man. Yeah, homemade are better anyway.
So when I was a kid, they used to make fun of me and call me Taco Bender, and that was considered an insult.
Not anymore.
No, not anymore.
I think that's a high level of praise now, Virginia.
That's it.
Funny how things change.
I have something to show you.
Please. You'll
be envious of. Okay, so you were talking about Rodney.
We live in Hawaii, Virginia. We're already envious from the start. There is no like, oh, now we'll be envious. No. You live in Hawaii on a ranch, for God's sake. Oh, you're muted.
You were talking about Rodney Smith.
Oh. Yes.
This is his marketing book. I got it on eBay for $12. It's meringue, but it's a little tiny diamond pattern on the cover with that color he used on his last two books. So you open it up and it's got the title with that color. He used a graphic designer for his last three books.
What's the name of the book?
It's Rodney Smith Photography with, it's 1970 to 2003. So I think it's from 2003. In the back, it tells you, it's a marketing book. It's where to find, it says like where to find him with all his info on the back page.
Oh, great.
And then it's a sample of all his work from that time period of the 70 to 2000, early 2000s. And then here are the images. And so some of the images are full page and some are little boxes.
Well, his blog was one of the bright spots of the mid 2000s for me. Yeah. Beautiful.
I met him in Palm Springs when he was teaching the first Palm Springs I volunteered at. I didn't know who he was. He was just this really, he was wearing like a photography vest. He looked like he was going on safari, but he was going into the desert to photograph on location. So he was wearing all khaki. Anyway, but very, very neat, you know, and he was telling stories to people. So I sat nearby and listened.
How would you describe him? Because I never met him. I was in the same room with him once and he was talking and the whole bit, but he was very erudite. It's wonderful. He listened to classical music. He read vociferously, probably read every great book on the planet.
Tell that in his conversation.
Yes. And he was
referenced literature.
Mild mannered. Never raised his voice. People loved, assistants loved working with Rodney because he was a very nice man to work for. There was never drama on Rodney's sets, even though if you go back and read the blog, and I encourage you, all of you, to read the blog, because it's not just like, oh, here's how I shot something on white background. It's about three models having a hissy fit in trailers in the middle of the Gobi Desert during a fashion shoot for Vogue. And he has to like wrangle these three supermodels who are ready to kill each other kind of thing. It's just really great. And this is from a guy that, you know, he was like really there. The thing about Rodney, and you bring Rodney up because Rodney is on my mind when I talk about The Only, because you talk about The Only. No one can copy Rodney Smith. You go and take a guy out in a suit and a bowler and put him in the middle of the frame. I'm sorry. They're going to go, oh, you're copying Rodney Smith. You own something that much. That is really, really incredible.
Yeah, he definitely was.
Anybody not familiar with Rodney Smith? Anybody? Good.
He had the attention. He drew a crowd in just his storytelling in the lobby during the festival. Just because he was a good storyteller. And
yeah, I always thought he'd make a hell of a writer.
But you can see from his pictures, he's storytelling. So that's what's in, but he has a sense of whimsy and a sense of humor, but it's not like obvious humor. It's like you have to listen, you know, for the humor in his conversation. And you kind of have to, you can see it in his pictures a little bit. So I think it was a good person to talk about.
Yeah.
Just because he's, like you said, he's the only, and there's a lot, like Irving Penn is very much that way too. You look at their work and you can tell it's their work.
I think there's a few. There's Irving Penn, there's Avedon. I mean, it's Avedon's hard to miss. Probably in some ways, Annie Leibovitz. In some ways, and I know there's the French photographer that we studied that we did in portrait class that used the wide angle.
There's a current photographer, Erwin Olaf. I heard him speak in Palm Springs too, and he's been on the art news a lot lately. He has a very distinct look. It's because I'm doing this workshop, and one of the assignments is a stage scene, and he is the master of the stage scene, and his work is so perfect. It's very spare, but he's same thing with he does it in a different way, how Rodney Smith tells a story with a spare, minimal composition.
Right. I was just going to add Gregory Crudson to that. Stephen Shore might fit in that group really well. Frank Auchenfels maybe also. But there's just so many that really have these really defined styles. And by being the only person that does certain things, is what we're striving for whenever we do marketing, is to be remembered. How do we get remembered? And being the only becomes one of the pieces of the puzzle to be remembered by. You know, it's why rock and rollers wear outrageous clothes. It's why Steven Tyler's a 65-year-old guy running around looking like he's 21. It's because it's part of the branding. It's how you remember. Because Steven Tyler cut his hair, shaved, and put on a polo shirt and some shorts, nobody'd even know who the hell he was. He'd just be another old guy, right? So he maintains his brand. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that at all. I think we all need to keep our own brand in mind. Who else has something to bring up? Did this bring any ideas to the foreground? Any ideas you may have about how you can move your work into a category of only? Now, we do have a photographer here in the group that does some only stuff, and that's Sophie. She does a lot of now. Sophie's not a full-time photographer. She works for the prison system in France, where she's the chief executioner. Now, this is I'm sorry, Sophie. You told me that in confidence, and now I've let the whole world know. I feel bad. But Sophie's always coming up with ideas that are only ideas. Like right now, she's doing this. How long have you done this? 3 years in a row now. The Movember.
Yeah, I was just shooting today for my third season of Movember.
Yeah, she does that. You did. You and Carmen did a together. Did a it was like a photo booth, right?
Yeah. We're hoping to do it again. It's a mix of art and photography to take people through an experience. And my latest series of headshots are also coming. I think what, because like my latest series, which is basically wacko headshots, the only thing was like, I did not have such bad hair throughout the whole winter for nothing. I had to get a picture out of it. That was my only motivation, really. It was just, I did not suffer this for no reason. I have to get a photo out of it. And so that for me, and now people are like, no, but they're so meaningful. I'm like, they can't be meaningful. It's just like, you know, it's I think it's interesting, like, because for me, it's just like, let's just have a laugh. A lot of the times, that's what the main reason behind my photography. Yet, I do it very seriously.
Yes.
I take it seriously when I'm doing it. And so, and it ends up expressing something else that's beyond me sometimes, that's beyond my wanting.
When you can use photography to discover something more about what you're interested in, or, and this is one of my go-tos for if you're in a slump, what to do, go and photograph something that you do not have a clue about. Like for me, bicycle racing. I've never seen one. I've never attended one. I have no interest in bicycle racing, but that would be something that I would then use to go out and as a catalyst to get me thinking creativity. But all you
come up with
very interesting ideas that are
generally way out of the mainstream. I mean, you're not, you know what I'm saying? You're not coming up with the same, I think I'll go out and shoot portraits of millennials standing against a wall. Yeah, that's not been done much. You always have interesting take. Sophie went out and shot a series of artists in their studios. Ended up shooting in a studio that was about the size of a broom closet, I swear to God. And she pulled it off. She got it done.
With your help.
Well, help is great, but you still have to be the one to execute it.
Yeah, so. but it's I think it's true that I'm lucky that I will find almost anything interesting to photograph. And that's where I'm lucky, because I'll just have fun doing it. Nobody will be interested, but I had so much fun.
I had a photographer who lives in one of the most beautiful places on the planet say, well, we're in lockdown, so I can't go more than two or three blocks. I think it's three blocks. It's kind of like where you are, Sophie, where Antibes. I think it's the same kind. You can go like three blocks or something.
Yeah.
Same type of lockdown. He's not too far from you. And he says, I just can't think of anything to shoot. And I wanted to reach through the screen and strangle him. Are you kidding? People from Toledo, Ohio, pay thousands of dollars to go to your little town to spend a week there. So they can, you've got three blocks. You got nine blocks. Well, 12, three, 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 and three. And you tell me there's nothing to photograph. Well, I like to shoot people. Well, you can't right now, right? That's why I always say embrace the process. You can't shoot people. That's not allowed in his little town. He's in Spain. Not allowed. So shoot doors, windows, shoot blades of grass, for Christ's sake. Whatever you do, just do it. And if nobody likes it, doesn't matter. You're doing it. Think of it as a bodybuilder. Bodybuilder comes along and says, oh, COVID's gone, is here now. So I can't go and bodybuild. So I'm just going to sit around and watch Netflix and eat chips, right? COVID's over and goes to the gym. What does he do? He probably weighs 40 pounds more. He's got no upper body strength. His legs are gone, right? Because he didn't exercise. Exercise, camera to face, exercise. That's brain. One of my go-tos in the upcoming book is, you know, set your alarm for an hour whenever you're on the road for hour. When it rings for an hour, pull over and make a photograph. Don't tell me there's not a photograph there, because I guarantee you there's a photograph there. You're blocking it out with your brain saying there's not a photograph here. Be quiet, be still, listen, close your eyes, look at it sideways, do 100 things. There's a photograph there. Is there a great photograph there? I don't know. You know the famous photograph of the migrant mom with the two kids by Dorothea Lange? We all know that photograph, right? It was towards the end of the day, it was getting late in the afternoon when she heard that these trucks and things were going to go up to this migrant camp. I think it's right outside of Santa Cruz, California, is where they were, Half Moon Bay, somewhere along in there. And she was tired. She was like, yeah, I ain't doing that. But then she found out she's the only photographer, that if she didn't go, no other photographer would go. So she thought, maybe I'll take advantage. And she went. Had she not gone, one of the greatest, most iconic photographs of the 20th century would not have been made. By her. It may have been made by somebody else, but it would not have been made by her because she didn't go. I'd rather be the only photographer in an area than standing in a group of 100 other photographers, which is why I don't do those photo shoots where all the photographers get together and, you know, shout at the model. They don't do that at Palm Springs thing, do they, Virginia? They don't like do those weird photo shoots. You're muted.
Which photo shoots?
you know, where they it's like camera club shoots where somebody's teaching a class and they go, okay. And then there's a model and there's 15 guys taking pictures of her.
No, I mean, they may do, so Mark Seliger did a setup where he went to a bar in India and put a motorcycle on top of the counter. It's like a biker bar that's well known. And they let him shoot there for a couple of days. And so he did that setup, but it's like, and everybody has to come up with, actually he, I think that was the only time he let anyone shoot. And it was more like, what would you do to change it so that we're not all shooting the same thing?
Yeah.
And so in your own way. And that's why it took a couple of days so that they, because he didn't want anyone shooting the same thing.
See, that reminds me of assignment that I've given just recently, which is to go and find an ad, hopefully an ad in a local magazine. So Melvin something in Montreal, Mark something in Columbus, maybe Columbus Magazine. Find an ad and then redo it your way. Redo it your way. The only thing you have to remember is it's got to fit the layout. So you treat the layout as sacrosanct. That's it. You shoot it your way. What if you discover there's, you know, Bob's Beanery or something, and they've got a photograph and you go, oh, that's pretty crappy. What if you discover you can't make a better photograph than that? That's called a learning opportunity. Maybe you've got to get your shit together so you know how to shoot a hamburger with beans on it. See what I'm saying? Try to do what someone else has done, but do it your way and see if you can come out with something that's more pleasing to you or other viewers. The concept's already been done. Somebody was hired to shoot that thing. I don't have it in here. Thank God. I had a flyer in the mail from Carl's Jr. And it's a hamburger with these fried potatoes. And it's like one of the worst photographs I've ever seen of food. And it's an 8.5 by 11 photograph. It's like, what are they thinking? Because Carl's Jr. generally does good photography. The backside with all the little coupons, all that stuff was good. This was terrible, just terrible. Can you make a better shot? Can you make a shot that's more unique? Can you make that image look better? That's a really valuable thing to know.
You get work that way locally. I've done
I would say, yeah, you could, but I'm using it more as a educational approach, Virginia. But yeah, you absolutely could.
I mean, not without said, not sending them the ad that you
do. No, you don't send them the ad, you send them the photograph.
Then you know your work. Okay. Yes. If you're looking for pictures of hamburgers, I can do pictures of hamburgers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But and you know what? People who work in ad agencies who are doing let's say they're doing Carl's Jr.'s. I think the biggest mistake in the world is to send them more pictures of hamburgers. I really do. Because I think they're tired of hamburgers. I think they're sick to death of hamburgers. I think
that's how they came up with their ad campaign of that girl that was kind of famous for Hilton, the Paris Hilton. Remember, she'd be washing a car or something. Tell them about the hamburger. But it wasn't about the hamburger at all. It was about Paris Hilton or whatever she was doing. My friend worked at Carl's Jr. Before that ad campaign, and somebody sent them pictures that had nothing to do with hamburgers. I mean, they were... Exactly. The last picture in the portfolio was a hamburger. But it was more about... I don't even know. She told me, but it was... They got the contract because of that, what they sent in.
All of you have had this experience. You can pick up a picture of a car in the middle of the Mojave Desert and have it strike a chord, and all of a sudden you've got an idea for a portrait in the studio, right? It's not like one for one. It's not like, well, there's a car in the Gobi Desert. I better shoot a car in the Gobi Desert. You look at the car and you go, oh, look how it's, you know, centered, and look how the light's casting that big. And all of a sudden now you're thinking of, you know, a portrait of somebody sitting up against the wall, casting the shadow, kind of like the car is doing, because your brain's going to take it and just go out with the idea. If all you can see is shooting another car, then you've got to practice letting your mind reach out. You've got to practice that, while exercise that muscle. I'm a huge believer in that no matter where you are on the planet, with possibly a few exceptions, like, I don't know, the middle of the Iraq desert or Barstow, California, wherever you are, other than those places, there's got to be a photograph in front of you. Even if it's as simple as your hand, there's a photograph to be made. We tend to want to do something magnificent. We're out looking for pictures. Our brains are full of Instagram photographs of the Rocky Mountains that have been photoshopped like crazy. And we're, you know, just north of Phoenix in the mountains there. They're never going to live up to that hype. Maybe they don't have to. Maybe they got their own hype. We just have to let it in. You know, let your mind breathe. Let your creativity breathe. And then you'll have more opportunities, I think, to make interesting photographs.
This is kind of interesting because yesterday when we were on the way back to Ohio from Maine, I took a detour and we went to Buffalo and Niagara Falls and stopped there on the way back. And the weather was horrible, which, you know, you get wet when you're there anyways, but I was fascinated because we went to the Cave of the Winds. So you go down an elevator and then out this tunnel and you come out to where the bottom of the waterfalls are at. And we came out there and there was probably 1,000 or 2,000 seagulls down there flying around. And when we was walking around, my wife and I were talking about photography and I was like, you know, it's probably going to be hard to get pictures or a challenge to get pictures of Niagara Falls, because so many people go there, so many people take pictures of it. And then thinking about what we're talking about now, it's kind of triggering in my head because I recently put my seagull prints for Maine on for sale. And when we was there, I was taking more pictures of the birds than I was of Niagara Falls, because I think, you know, there's such, you know, the seagulls are kind of like the trashy bird or whatever, but they have such personality when you're watching them interact with each other. So doing like a little book that's seagulls at Niagara Falls, where Niagara Falls is kind of like the background, but not the focus of it, or walking around there and, you know, taking pictures of Niagara Falls, but what's around Niagara Falls that you don't see when you're so busy looking at the waterfalls, like taking a different perspective of being someplace, but not focusing on what everybody else is looking at.
Absolutely. It was very interesting. A photographer friend of mine, Gary Crabb, is a landscape photographer, and he has a whole series of photographs photographing the photographers photographing iconic places. So he shows up at Zabriskie Point before dawn, and he lost count at 450 photographers. And if you've ever been there, Kevin, you ever been to Zabriskie Point?
Yep, absolutely.
It's not a very big parking lot, right?
Nope. So
Your first clue that it's going to be crowded is you have to park a half a mile away on the side of the road.
Yeah.
And they're all vying for that one shot, the shot Ansel Adams did. They all want that shot. Now, the psychology of wanting that shot blows me away. I would be like, I don't want that shot. Ansel did it really good. Ed Weston did a really nice shot of it. Edward Munch has a really good shot of it. Is it Edward? What was his name? Munch. Anyway, has a great shot. And I'm there, and it's a cloudless, you know, September morning. Yeah, that's really awesome. Ugly gray sky and the sun popping into it, right?
Right.
On the side of the road, I'm coming down the road, just left Yellowstone. I'm going along the, just past the lake, along the Grand Tetons, right? And there's a white spot in the road. And I pulled over there because there were so many people. I thought, what's going on? Did somebody get hurt? There were cars everywhere. And it was the shot, Ansel Adams shot of the Snake River, the big horseshoe Snake River with the Tetons behind. There were 4x5 cameras set up there. There were probably, I would say 40 to 50 photographers. shooting the Tetons on an absolutely cloudless, dull 2 o'clock in the afternoon day. What's the point?
Yep.
I was so blown away. I wasn't mad. I wasn't disgusted or anything like that. I was just like, wow, you know. I walked over and to the edge and I couldn't get to the middle because all the photographers were like, they were tripod there. And I didn't even take an iPhone shot of it. I just went, oh, the hell with it. Moved on down. There wasn't a shot to be had that day. But Gary has that same shot in the fall when all the trees are changing color. But he's across the street photographing the Tetons, right? With about 300 photographers lined up there. All the backs of their heads. All the backs of them. And you can see the tripods. Killer shot. Killer shot. He's the only one that went across the street to shoot that. That was what was interesting. Same thing with he's got a picture from Machu Picchu. Same thing. You know, the hold the camera up and there's 1,000 photographers taking the same picture. You know. So it's like you gotta stand out from the crowd. Doesn't mean every photograph you take has to be super unique. Just means, what are you going to do? What kind of ideas are you going to have or come up with that you can say, at least this is mine. This is, I'm the only. Right now, Virginia is the only photographer, Project 52 photographer on the Big Island. You're on the Big Island, right, Virginia? On the Big Island. We got a photographer over on, is it Oahu is the other island? You got Hawaii, Oahu, and the one that everybody goes to, but nobody.
Maui.
And Maui. Everybody visits Maui, nobody lives there.
Well, I'm pretty much probably going to be the only one not shooting everybody on the beach. Although I did find a cool location this week, I'll shoot, do some shooting in. Because, you know, if you live in Hawaii and you want a family picture, or because I got to do the local genre, it's not a big area.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of business owners already have said, oh, yeah, I want to do business with you, but can you also do my family? So mm-hmm. I have to do it different, and because they already probably have a picture on the beach. You know, yeah. I have a studio and I have a 3 acres of, you know, banana tree grove and mother ferns and, you know, all that stuff where that makes a good background too, you know?
There's beaches in Hawaii?
Yeah, the Big Island doesn't really have that many on this side. But people go to the other side. It's like, oh, I got to get my family on the beach. Well, how many pictures of your family on the beach do you need in a lifetime?
Yeah. Yeah.
You'll never get one from me.
Now, is the big mountain on your island or is the big mountain on another island?
This one. So there's snow on this one on Mauna Loa. Right. And then there's like a bunch of volcanoes. So there's more than one mountain.
I would think that the incredible forest up around the mountain would make far more interesting family portraits than the beach.
Yeah. There's a eucalyptus forest on the north. There's a redwood forest somewhere, but we haven't gone to see it yet. And right down the street, there's it's called a lava stump park or something. It's when the lava came and burned a bunch of trees, but it kind of looks phallic, so I don't know. Would shoot there, but there are areas with those monstera, like people are buying houseplants and everyone loves monsteras and they're these cute little pots. Well, they're about 40 feet tall. It looks like dinosaur land over there. So
oh, fun.
I think that would be good to take pictures over there.
Yeah. And if you're like, you know, when we say the only, but if you're kind of like the only one doing that, you've got that thing, you've got something going for you. I never thought of it this way back when I was encouraging everybody to shoot film, and I'm still encouraging you, especially if you're a Nikon shooter, just pick up an F3 or an F4 on eBay for $300-400 because all your lenses fit. Well, F4 anyway, F4 or F5, all your autofocus lenses will fit those cameras. So instead of having to buy a whole new kit, just do that.
But film sets you apart, right? It just sets you apart. The fact that you have something, that you do something in film, puts another layer on your offering. It does not mean, and I know this is going to come to a come as a huge blow to many YouTubers, but here's a real truism. Just because it was shot on film does not make it worth looking at.
Right.
It, you know, if it's a bunch of boring crap, the fact that you shot it on, you know, Kodak color just isn't a defining factor for anybody. Who cares? Right? I've seen so many, because I clicked on two in a row with film photography. So now when I go to my YouTube, if I popped it up, I'd have about five or six YouTubes about film photography. And it's like street photography with the Konica XT and two rolls of Tri-X. And you kind of go, okay, you look at it, it's terrible. You know, I'm sorry, just because it's shot film doesn't make it great. But if you shoot a really good photograph on film, it makes it rare. And rare is good. Rare is good. Not bad to have rare.
I've been shooting a lot of film lately on my Mia, and really liking the results that I'm getting.
You shouldn't medium format Mamiya?
Yeah, 6.45.
6.45, yeah.
Yeah, and man, it's making me want to go to the digital 6.4, the digital medium format as well. So
that's a nice camera, the Mamiya. I shoot a Pentax, and I just got a Pentax 6.45Z, a digital version, but I haven't really. I just started shooting with it.
Yeah, they're pretty nice. That 6.45Z is nice, really nice. Nice camera. There's they've got them up on. They're on eBay. A lot of people who buy those cameras move up to the next camera. There's a lot of people in the digital photography space that really do believe it has something to do with the camera. You know, they're the people who trades in their Mark II for a Mark III, then they get a Mark IV, and then they get a Mark V, and then they get a Mark VI. Photography never improves.
Right.
Now they've got bigger megapixels, boring images. 6.45 is really great. One of our members, Pete Visser from Bend, Oregon, has bought the Fuji, the I don't know, it's about 10 grand.
Yeah, that's the 50SR.
What is it?
50SR.
Yeah, it's a medium format. Medium
format. That's like 54 megapixels.
He's absolutely loving it, Kevin. And I know 10 grand's a lot of money, but you know, you start looking at some of those Hasselblads.
I'm looking at the Hasselblad 907X, and man, it's just everything I see on that is just beautiful. So
if you get something used on that site, keh.com, right. I got my 6.45Z on there, and with a year warranty. I think they had a special where they were extending their 90-day warranty to a year. And that's why I got it. And plus it was a great price. I have the 6.45 lenses from my film camera, so I can use them.
Yeah. So I priced out a system, and it's probably going to cost about 23 grand to do the whole thing. So, but
$23,000?
Yes, sir. that was my grandson.
Well, do this. See now, are you married, Kevin?
Yeah.
Okay. So here's how all of you married folks, this is how you sell it to your significant other. We'll go with lighting. Okay. What you do is you pull up Broncolor on the web, Broncolor lights.
Yeah.
And then you call your wife or your husband over and say, you know, I really want to be a photographer. I got to have lights. Look at these things are $18,000.
Yeah.
You really have to have those? Absolutely. If I'm going to be a photographer, I've got to have lighting. Well, that's a lot of money. I know, honey. About an hour later, you call, honey, come here. Look, Pro photos are only $4,000. I'm saving $14,000.
Yeah.
Faust goes, well, that's a hell of a savings. Yeah, yes, it is.
For a limited time only.
Yeah.
Yeah. Enter a shipping address like that. See? I gotta save 14 grand, honey. I mean, no, these aren't quite as good, but they'll get me by.
Yeah.
They'll do it in a pinch. All right. Any last thoughts? Think about being the only in something that you do, something that you can present.
Yeah.
Most of you have probably already done it. I know Kevin has something. I know Mark has something. Lee is a budding commercial photographer who is also a successful photojournalist. So
it's the kind of
that helps set her apart as well. So bringing a photojournalism along with the commercial is cool.
Yeah.
Virginia too. I also know Virginia's done an awful lot of things. She's a prop stylist, wardrobe stylist, you know, brings a whole lot to the table. All right, folks, everybody have a great weekend. I will be on social media this weekend. Next weekend, I will not. I am going to take a little bit of a break from I hate it when people go, I'm not going to be on social media. I'm quitting social media. But you just announced that on, you know, Twitter. I mean, do you know how stupid that sounds?
Yeah.
You know? So I'm not.
You got to take a break to get stuff done.
Yeah.
You know what? I want to do something on the weekends. And it's not that I'm addicted to Facebook. I'm not addicted to Medium. I'm not really. It's just too damned easy, isn't it? It's too easy to sit down and go, pick up the phone and boom.
Yeah.
Now, and there goes a half an hour of your day. This next weekend, I'll sit down and I'll pick up a book. Y'all remember books, right? They're heavy. They got paper and stuff. They smell good.
Turn the page. You know?
Turn the page. Absolutely.
Right, turn the page.
All right. Everybody, have a great one. And we'll see you next week is bring a photo. Next week is bring a photo. Bring a photo. Okay. Tell us about it. All right.
Take care. Sounds good.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Bye, everybody.